So my name is Hernani, and first of all, I'd like to thank the opportunity to present my work here and share my initial results with you. And as Luis Felipe said, my advisor is Alexandre Rocha, who gives to us that 3 days lectures in the last week. And my co-advisor is Dr. Gustavo Feliciano, of the same university, but another city. We are placed in the city of São Paulo. Here we talk about QMMM and electronic transport simulations for detecting DNA hybridization using graphene. Well, the outline of my presentation is the following. I will introduce the biosensors, the DNA and graphene. I will explain a little bit why to detect the DNA. To do this, I will show some results of our group, and I will explain the idea of using graphene as a device. Then I will explain you the methodology that you have used, which is QMMM calculations, molecular dynamics, DFT, and electronic transport calculations, and I will try to explain step by step all the methodology. And then I will show you my results, and then I will conclude and explain the next steps that we are going to do. Okay. First of all, I have to introduce the idea of a biosensor. A biosensor is a device to detect systems of biological interest. Here we have a picture with the general idea of a biosensor. We have the analyte here, a bioselective material here. We have the biorecognition sign that can be electricity, pH change, can be heat, light, or mass change. And we have the transducer here that can be electrode, thermistor, and so on. After signalization, we have the data processing the results. Well, as a bioselective material, we can have the bioselective material that defines the kind of system that you are going to detect with your biosensor. We can have as a bioselective material, for example, enzymes, or we can have an antibody if you wanted to detect, for example, a certain kind of protein, or we can have the DNA. We can use the DNA, a single-strand DNA, to detect the DNA hybridization. That's the case of this work. Well, the DNA is a very, very large system that's composed by smaller units. The smaller units are shown here on the right side. These smaller units are called nucleotides, and the nucleotides are composed by a sugar molecule and a phosphate group here, and the nucleobase. We can have 4 different nucleobases: adenine, thymine, cytosine, guanine. And the interaction between the nucleotides here is by pairs. This nucleotide interacts with this, and this with this. So this kind of interaction is strong and so specific. Well, graphene, we heard a lot about graphene during this school and workshop, is a material with the thickness of an atom, one atom. And because of this, it can be used as sensing material, for example. It's a very good candidate to be used as sensing material because a lot of high, a very good properties. Particularly the high electron conductivity, for example, for our case here. We want to construct a full electronic device. So graphene is a very good candidate. But why to detect the DNA, and why use graphene to do that? By detecting DNA, we can make a DNA sequence, for example. That's a very important area of research. Or we can lead with disease detection, for example, cancer, hepatitis B, and all of the kinds of disease that are related with DNA mutations. And the graphene, as I said in the previous slide, is a very good candidate because of its unique properties. And the big available surface area allows us a lot of different kinds of interactions between the DNA and graphene. We can have, for example, nanopore, we can have nanogaps or physisorption. The case of my work is the physisorption, but I will show you the idea of the nanopores with the results of my group, some results of my group. So the first one will be the graphene as a device by nanopores. I will use here the a few results of the group. I didn't participate of this work, but I will try to explain you. The idea is the following. You have here the graphene, Here the representation of the leads. You have the nanopore, and we have hydrogen atoms here in the nanopore. And then you pass the single-strand DNA in the pore. All the systems inside water and the counter ions. Well, the idea is to detect each nucleic base by changes in the electronic environment when the base is inside the pore. So you can make you can calculate the electronic transport through graphene. And when we have one nucleic base here, we can have a signal. When you have the other nucleic base, the signal can be different. So the idea of the detection is based in this proposal. Well, here the transmission that they found. The first one here is only water. The system, that nanopore, that graphene nanopore inside water. This is the difference between the average of the calculations and the dry system without liquid. So this is the difference. Here is the, it is not the difference, it's the transmission for each nucleic base, as you can see in the colors. And this dotted line here is the system without liquid, the dry system. And here's the difference between each curve here and the dotted one. As you can see here, it's not so easy to detect each nucleic base by this method. But they found in the paper, the reference is in the previous slide, but I will show you again in the end. They found that the charge of the nucleic base play a central role in this system, because the coupling between the base and the electrodes could be increased in the signal. So you can use another atoms in the nanopore in order to get a large signal difference. Well, the other way is the graphene as a device by fusion sorption. That's the case of my PhD project. The idea here is the following. You can have the graphene here, and we can put anchor molecules above graphene in order to connect the DNA in graphene by PP stack interactions. And then when we have the system with the single-strand DNA, we have an electronic environment. So we can calculate the electronic transport in this system. And after, when we have the double-strand DNA above graphene, the electronic environment will change, and we expect that the electronic transport will also change. And that's the basic idea of the detection of the DNA hybridization using graphene in a device like that. And all the system is inside water and counter ions to simulate the environment of the DNA. Well, but how can we simulate a system like that? Because we have thousands of atoms, because we have all the water, counter ions. This is a dynamical system, and we need a quantum description of the system, because we want to calculate the electronic transport, so we need a quantum description of the system. Well, we can use a QMMM methodology, which is a multi-scale method. The main idea of in this method here is divide your system in two different parts. One part will be treated quantically, and the other part will be treated classically. Well, here is we have two snapshots of my systems, and the left side we have the single-strand DNA, and the right side we have the double-strand DNA. Well, the classical part of the system that we choose is all the liquid and the liquid, which is the water and counter ions. Back to the full system. And now we have the quantum part of the system. Of course, we need the graphene to be treated quantically, because we will calculate the electronic transport through graphene. And we choose all the DNA, single strand or double strand, and the number of positive ions that we need to equilibrate the charge of the system, since we have a negative charge in each phosphate group. Well, that's the idea of the QMMM method. But to simulate the system, we run molecular dynamics calculation for the systems to generate our snapshots, and we do the QMMM calculations in all the snapshots that we choose. I know that we heard about molecular dynamics here, but I'm not going into in details. What we do in molecular dynamics is to solve the Newton's equation of motion. The relation between the force and the potential is in this equation here. So what we do is the simultaneous solution of the equations in small time step, in my case, 2 picoseconds. We determine a certain time of calculation from nanoseconds to microseconds, depends on the problem that you want to study. And the coordinates are written in output file equally spaced, and then we can see all the structures that we have. This is the typical force field, a general expression for a typical force field. We have this first term that is related with the bond between the atoms. We have the angles, dihedrals, and the non-bonded terms. The non-bonded terms are here Lennard-Jones potential and a Coulomb potential. Well, to be clear, we have to define all the bonds for our system. So for all the atoms here, the angle is the angle between three atoms here, as you can see here. The dihedral is defined between four atoms. And we have to define the pairs for the non-bonded terms. But we need to get these parameters from somewhere. For example, experimental data or quantum calculations. You can run quantum calculations for a smaller part of the system and get these parameters here to run your molecular dynamics calculation. Well, since we have the positions for the nuclei, we can solve the electronic problem separately. And then we have the electronic Hamiltonian here, and we have an equation like the Schrödinger equation for the electronic part. And we can solve this by Hartree-Fock method, perturbative methods, variational methods, which are methods based on the wave function. We can choose the dense functional theory. That's a totally different method because it's based on the electronic density of the system to solve the electronic part. Of the Hamiltonian. Well, the main idea in the DFT theory is that the basic variable of the system is the electronic density. With this, we have a drastic reduction in the number of variables. Since with a system of n electrons and 3n variables is reduced to a three-dimensional problem. So this is a very drastic reduction. And the use of the electronic density for as a fundamental variable of the system was archived by Homberg and Kohn. And further studies of Conchon lead to the equations that we use today to make the DFT calculation. And here to remember, the electronic density of the system is defined in this equation here. Well, in the Conchon formalism, we can write the energy as a functional of the electronic density of the system. This first term here is the kinetic energy of the electrons. Here is the exchange and correlation energy. This is the Hartree-Fock term, that is the average potential between electrons. And the last one is an external potential. Here, this term is in blue because the way to include the exchange and correlation energy is the thing that differentiates between the functionals that you can have. And this last term here is an external potential due to the nuclei, but can be an external potential. For example, the external potential of the classical part, as I will show you. Well, the DFT and the QMMM are related with two Nobel Prizes in chemistry. The first one for these two researchers here in 1998, and more recently, the multi-scale methods, which includes the QMMM, for these three researchers here. The electronic transport. Alexandre gave to us in the last week all the theory behind the electronic transport. So here we have a graphene, for example. We have the two leads, the left one, the right one. We have a buffer region here in the left side and the right side. And here the potential should be smooth. And all this region here is the scattering region. We can have a Green's function for the system. Here we have the self-energy of the leads, and we can calculate the transmission as a function of the energy for the system. Well, now I'll explain you step by step all the methodology to get the final result of electronic transport of this solvated system. The first step is to run molecular dynamics calculation. And I did this for 10 nanoseconds using NPT ensemble. And with the average length of the perpendicular direction to the graphene plane, I did more 10 nanoseconds, but now NVT. From this, I have extracted 10 snapshots. And in these snapshots are equally spaced by 1 nanosecond. And the partition of the QM part and MM part, as I said before, is the following. The graphene, the DNA, and the number of positive ions that we need to equilibrate the charge is the quantum part of the system. And all the rest is the classical part of the system. Okay, over all these 10 snapshots, we did the external potential calculations for the classical part. The QMMM calculation is a DFT calculation. Reading the external potential calculated in the previous step, and with the Hamiltonian generated here, we can calculate the electronic transport. Well, our simulations parameters were the following. For the DFT calculation, we have used the PPA functional with DZ base set for the graphene and DZP for all the rest. And our molecular dynamics calculations were done using the amber force field and the SPC model for the water. And the electronic transport calculations were made in 500 points from minus 10 to minus 0.5 EV. And the programs that we have used to do all these calculations were the following. The Gromex were used to run the molecular dynamics calculation. And the VMD program, that's a visualization program, was used to make all the separation between the quantum part and the classical part of the system. It's very easy to script in VMD, so I think that is a very important program to lead with a lot of structures. And you have used the Siesta code to run both external potential and the DFT reading this external potential, the hybrid version of the Siesta. And finally, to get the electronic transport, we have used this MIGO code. Well, now I will start with my results. My box parameters are almost all the same because we have the graphene on the bottom of the box. This is a periodic system. And the length of the box is this. This graphene sheet have 572 carbon atoms. It's all quantically. And here we have the box parameter for the single strand and the double strand. The unique difference here is the length in the perpendicular direction. And also the difference between the number of the positive ions and the negative ions. Here, I want to identify an external potential that we can calculate using this methodology. We have in the left side a single strand DNA, on the right side a double strand DNA. I know that's impossible to see anything here, but we can plot above this picture the external potential calculated. And here, these big spheres here are the counter ions. Here we have more negative ions, and because of that we have the negative potential, and here we have more positive ions, and because of that we have this positive potential. This is the external potential in this axis here, and this one is the Z direction. The Z direction is the direction of the electronic transport. So we have a lot of cuts in the Z direction, a lot of slices, and since we have more negative ions here, we have a negative potential. And vice versa. Okay. This is the electronic transport for pure graphene, dry graphene, without liquid. Here we have the total transmission coefficient. I will show a lot of plots like that for now. And here we have the energy, minus the Fermi energy. When we put the system above water, inside water, without counter ions here yet, we have a decrease of the transmission, as you can see here in this blue curve. I did this calculation over 200 different configurations for the liquid. So here we have an average. Well, now my system itself. On the right side here, we will always have the pure graphene and here the graphene inside the water and counter ions. Okay, so the system is showed here. When we put the single strand DNA, we have this curve here, this red curve, and these are all averages. And when we put the double strand DNA, we have this curve here. The signals are similar, so it's not easy to differentiate the single strand DNA and the double strand DNA in a device like that. The reasons to do can, the reasons to this result can be a lot, and we need more snapshots to make statistics because it's a dynamical system. Okay, but I tried another kind of configurations. For example, I have used now the DNA above graphene without anchor molecule. I have used the nucleobase itself as an anchor molecule. And then when we put the, and now I have a bigger system, and when we put the single strand DNA, we have this curve here. When we put the double strand DNA, we have almost the same result as before. And then I tried another configuration. I put the DNA in the horizontal, as you can see here. To do that, I applied the harmonic potential to keep the DNA in this area of graphene, only to see the influence. And with only the single strand DNA, we have this curve. And when we put the double strand DNA, now we have a signal. The difference between these two signals here are good to a device, for example, you can detect now, but we are studying this system. This is not a final result yet. Well, so to conclude the results that I present to you, I showed that graphene can be used as a biosensor for both DNA detection and DNA sequence. We can do a lot of different things with graphene, a lot of different research. The solvent must be taken into account, and to do that, we have used a method that combines quantum and classical mechanics to describe all the system. And then we can get the electronic transport of a solvated system. And our result for the electronic transport show that the two signals for the vertical DNA are similar, but the horizontal one is we have difference between these two signals. And as I said before, we are doing more studies in order to understand better the system. And I will show you now some of our next steps, the things that we the steps that we think that will increase the difference of the signal. For example, we can make polarization on graphene in order to include the effects of the polarization graphene. When repeat, it's not working well. Let me try to back. This is a model which calls GRAPPA force field. You can put above graphene a positive charge and below graphene a negative charge in each carbon atom. And this is a rigid rod model. This rod can rotate in such a way that we can have a specific mass, a specific distance, in such a way that we can simulate the polarization in graphene. And with this, we can, for example, our description for the interaction between the liquid and graphene can be better, and we can have a better signal. The other idea is to do the same with the bilayer system, also with polarization, with this model here. So we have a bilayer, we put the same positive charge and negative charge above graphene, and this is the general view of the system. We are studying the system on inside the water and counter ions now to see the difference in the signal. And if it works, if we have better results, we apply this for our DNA system. Okay, so in summary, my next steps are the following. I did something and something I will do yet. The large signal difference can be achieved by choosing other anchor molecules, for example, this one, or the DNA nucleobase itself, as I did, but it still not work. we can choose other criteria for selecting the snapshots. For example, average energy, more frequent energy, and we of course need more snapshots, more calculations. And I choose the structures equally spaced, so we can think in other criteria. And also the polarization graphene, as I said in the previous slide, we can start the monolayer graphene, the bilayer graphene, with the ridge rod model. Well, this is the web page of our group. This is the you can find us here. You can check for the open positions in Institute of Theoretical Physics in this web page and in the page of the institute. And I'd like to thank the one time the organizer for the opportunity, and I'd like to thank these two agencies here, and all of you for your attention. Thank you very much.